Hi guys, welcome to Cryptids Canada. I've got a really good story for tonight, but I'm hoping before I get started, you guys will like, share, and subscribe. And when you're done all that, sit back, put your feet up, and get ready to hear a pretty darn good story. Okay, so this one is just titled, My Whole World Was Just Blown Away. My dear friend Leslie, I came across your channel last year, quite by accident. I've never had an interest in cryptids of any kind. I've never really even heard of them. But, like I said, I stumbled upon your channel. The more I listened, the more I liked. I started surfing around. I found other channels that I liked as much as yours. So, I developed a great interest in this. I found that every spare moment I got, I went on the internet and started listening to your stories. So anyway, I went to stay with my aunt when the first lockdown happened in Calgary, Alberta. She was 76 and in excellent condition, mentally and physically. But as I'm her only family, it was my duty, I felt, to stay with her and do her shopping and so on. I was on lockdown as well, and the way I saw it is that she had far better internet than I did, and if I wasn't going to be doing anything else, I might as well take advantage of the fast, high-speed internet, laugh out loud. So, as I mentioned, I had stumbled upon your channel a couple of months earlier, and I was in the kitchen with my laptop, while my Aunt Winnette was in the living room beside the kitchen watching TV. I was watching one of your videos when I heard the TV go silent. Then Aunt Wynn came in and leaned over me. She looked at the video. She asked what this was about. I said Bigfoot. After a minute or two of her watching, I asked, did she believe in Bigfoot? And she said, yes, I do. After a few more minutes of watching, she asked if I'd ever heard Mom and Dad ever mention their Bigfoot experience. I was shocked to hear her say that because I had no idea. Both of my parents had passed away in the last 10 years. So I said, no. Why? What happened? She sat down and she said it was a fascinating story, but she had never repeated the story because the subject had just never come up. She asked if I had ever heard that my mom and dad and a friend of theirs from university took a backpacking trip across Europe in 1970. I actually remember them mentioning it, but I just didn't really remember any of the details, as I didn't really have an interest in it. But she said, well, I'll tell you what I remember, and I hope I get this right. So we made some tea, and Aunt Wynn started. They were having the time of their lives, staying in hostels, making friends, and sometimes just getting stuck sleeping under the stars. Although they did have camping gear. Sometimes they were so exhausted from walking that they would find a safe spot and throw down their sleeping bags and just zonk right out. So, as the story goes, they had made it to Indonesia. I recall the first few days they were all sick, coughing and fevers, so they made it to a nice place to camp in the woods. There was a rock wall that they placed their tent next to keep out the wind. They coughed and sat beside their fire trying to stay warm. All three were miserable. They went to bed in the tent and all three coughed all night. When they awoke the next morning, they climbed out of their tent and there was an old man sitting beside their stoked and fresh fire. The three moved up slowly and the man welcomed them with his wrinkly, toothless smile and bowed a hello. He spoke broken English, surprisingly, and the three students knew a little Indonesian, so they were able to have a broken conversation, and it turned out the old man owned the land and had heard them coughing all through the night. So he made them a pot of stew and also brought some home remedies to help with their bad cough. Of course, the kids appreciated the gesture and offered to move on. The old man offered to let them come and sleep in his modest hut, and the three again politely refused. The old man said they must stay and rest a few days at least so the medicine could work. He was very concerned about the kids staying in the wilds and said so. He said that there are wild men that roam these woods, and the kids agreed to stay for the 3 days, but they would prefer to stay where they were. Really, they just did not want to put the old man out. They asked the old man to stay for breakfast of tea and oatmeal. He declined and said he would come back later to check on them. As he was leaving, my aunt said my mother ran up and gave him a hug and a chocolate bar. The old man's face lit up with excitement because of the chocolate bar. The three sat by the fire, rested, and napped all day. At dinner time, they held off and waited for the old man. Finally, they just ate the delicious stew and crawled into the tent to go to sleep. They figured the old man got busy doing something else. The kids heard what sounded like sticks and leaves crunching. All three huddled into the center of the tent, expecting wolves or some kind of wild animal. The sounds were getting louder, and they knew whatever it was right beside them. They could hear very loud, deep breathing, and then scratching on the side of their tent. When the creature moved away from their tent, my father silently moved to the tent opening, and my aunt said he stiffened and covered his own mouth with both of his hands. He whispered, "It's a Bigfoot," and each girl took their own peek. All three were petrified, and then the Bigfoot reached his hand into the nearby pot that was on the rock beside the fire. The Bigfoot pulled his hand back and screamed so loud the kids had to cover their ears. He kicked the pot till it was out of sight, and then it jumped around as it swooped the forest floor with its very long arms. Dirt and leaves went flying in all directions. They described the sounds that the raging Bigfoot was making as the same kind of sounds a chimpanzee would make. Then it took off at full speed and rammed into a tree. The tree creaked and groaned as the tree started to fall over. The sounds of the trees falling all through the woods could be heard for about 20 minutes. The kids started panicking again as they heard running footsteps coming up on them again. They heard the familiar sound of the old man yelling as he made his way closer to camp. Kids came out of the tent when they saw the old man with what looked like an old rifle. The old man said, "Let's go, come with me." When they started to gather things up, he said, "No, leave it till morning. We will come back in the morning." So the kids did just that, and they grabbed their flashlights. They all made their way back to the old man's grass and wooden hut. They were quite surprised that even though it was sparsely furnished, the wooden furniture was all handmade and beautifully carved. They asked the man how he found them without a flashlight in the pitch dark. He just smiled and shook his shoulders. They were made comfortable and they all slept. By morning, they were all feeling much better, and the old man took them back to their camp, talking about the wild man as they walked. Luckily, the camp was untouched, and they packed it all up quickly. They did stop to look at the tree that was pushed over, and they estimated that it was about 20 inches around. The old man got them a ride to the closest train station because the kids were more than ready to move on to their next destination. A hotel and a restaurant was the first on the list. Unfortunately, my parents didn't get to travel much further, as I was next on the itinerary. I was so excited to hear this and then to be able to send it to you to share with your subscribers. Please stay safe, Leslie, in this very crappy situation. And it's signed Jordy Mills. Well, of course, I thank you for that, and I hope you stay safe too. I loved your story. It was a really, really good story, and it was very well written. Thank you. Thank you so much, Jordy. Okay, guys, I think I've got time to do another one. Okay, this one is called Aircraft, Spacecraft, or UFO. Hello, I have always loved legends and mysteries. From a young age, I always watched cryptids on television. Anything from the Loch Ness Monster, gargoyles, dogman, aliens, and too many others to mention, and some that most people have probably not even thought about. I have to say, Bigfoot is my favorite, and UFO aliens come in a close second. This is not my experience, but that of my husband, Jim. It feels wrong that someone like myself never gets an experience, but many others I know have, and they could care less. Anyhow, I will do my best to tell it from his point of view. Jim drove a tractor trailer for a living. We live in Central Texas, and this was the winter of 2007. Jim had made a delivery many hours away and was on his way back home. By now, it had gotten late and it was very dark out. He was getting closer to home, and because it's dark and on rural roads, he was watching for animals crossing the road. It was not unusual to see deer, raccoons, rabbit, etc., and it's hard to stop a tractor trailer quickly, so he was always going at a slower rate of speed. When, all of a sudden, an aircraft appeared just above and in front of his rig. He could see the lights, an off-white and soft white color, not red and green lights like you see on an airplane. So he slowed down even more, trying to see the shape and form. The lights would phase out from the left and phase back in on the right. It was so strange. Jim was mesmerized. He just kept watching. He couldn't see a shape, and it was just floating and hovering there with the lights phasing from the left to the right. Wait, they aren't phasing out. The aircraft was rotating around. Jim rolled down his window and he listened, but it was silent, no sounds at all. He felt around and grabbed his spotlight, and he flashed it at the aircraft to get a better look. Seconds later, the lights just disappeared, as if those in the aircraft were startled that he had taken such a keen interest in them. He still could not see anything, even with the spotlight. He didn't see anything after that, so he resumed on his way home. He was very excited and could not wait to tell me all about it. Yes, it could have been some military aircraft or even civilian, but you tell me, what kind of aircraft hovers and rotates and is silent and doesn't have a proper red and green lights? Well, that was Jim's encounter. My brother and his wife had a similar encounter around the same time. They lived an hour away. Then, in early 2008, our town exploded with the news of UFOs. If you haven't heard about the Stevensville, Texas UFO stories, just Google it. So many people we knew had seen them, except for me. I always watched the woods and the skies, hoping to see something extraordinary. Meanwhile, I'll keep listening to your show. I appreciate you. And I appreciate you. Thank you so much for taking the time to write your husband's story down. I hope, really, really do hope, that you get to have your own experience sooner than later, and hopefully it's a really good positive one. Anyways, guys, I think that is gonna be it for today. I enjoyed my time with you, and I hope you enjoyed your time with me. Hopefully you have an amazing evening. We'll see you back here in a couple of days. Bye for now.